We sponsor the health center because we believe in its program. We believe what they try to do with the young people that come in, and also the young mothers that want help. And I think it's one of the most fabulous programs that we have in this area. And it's one of the few outside of our church that we do sponsor. If there's a road I should walk, help me find it. If I need to be still, give me peace for the moment. Whatever
I volunteered at the Pregnancy Help Center because as a young father, I didn't have all the tools I needed to raise my child, and it was a learning process. The Pregnancy Help Center offers to these young dads a basic foundation on not just the physical but the spiritual. The physical as far as how to handle a young child, supporting the head, how to swaddle it in a blanket, how to change the diapers, and how to, you know, care for it physically, and also to teach them how important the father figure is in this child's life. But also we have the opportunity to spiritually bring in our Father in heaven to the class at the Pregnancy Help Center and to these young dads, and explain to them how that is our ultimate role model, and how in the Bible we find direction on how to treat, care, and love our children, and how a father should be.
I think everybody should walk because it's a fun 2 miles with a bunch of activities and you get to do it with your friends.
I volunteer at the Pregnancy Help Center because I'm blessed by the opportunities to provide a Christian influence, support, and encouragement to the women I speak with through this ministry.
Because every time I take a step, I know I'm saving a baby's life.
Because it helps families choose life.
If there's a road I should walk, help me find it. If I need to be still, give me peace for the moment. Whatever your
And we would like to encourage all of you to be sponsors for this wonderful program that helps young people in their problems.
It's hard sometimes to sit in front of a camera and tell the passion of your heart, of why you do things. Trent, thank you so much for putting that video together. It's so powerful. The Pregnancy Help Center cannot wait until I share this video with them, because they know it will be a very powerful tool for helping people know and get involved and be a part of the Pregnancy Help Center. This is our 9th year, guys, as a church to participate in this ministry. 9 years. It's incredible. Our very first year, we had about 13 walkers. 2 were Cameron and Isaac Baca, just little bitty people that started, and they've been walking ever since. And we've grown to over 75 people that have participated in our Walk for Life. And it's because of the sponsors for those walkers and because of your participation and donations that over the last 8 years, we have been able to help the ministry with over $25,000. Is that incredible? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You know, abortion is a hotly debated topic in our country today that divides us. But I believe that right to life is nothing to do with politics. It has to do with the heart. And I tell you, the right to life of that unborn child is very, very important to most of us. But it's also the life of that mom and that family that find themselves in a very difficult, desperate, hopeless situation. And all of us, to some degree, have been affected by what can happen when that decision comes. It may have been your friend. It may be your sister. It may be your brother. It may be you. You may be a parent, you may be a grandparent that's sitting here today and that you know that you have a precious child at your table because a decision was made. Or maybe you know that there is a precious child that's missing from your table today. So I just ask you, you know, when you know that there is something that you can do for the future of a family that's facing a crisis like this, what would you do to help support them? I just thank you for all of you that have participated before. I just want you to raise your hand if you've ever, over the last 8 years, if you ever walked, if you ever participated in any way, if you sponsored, if you volunteered at the center, would you just raise your hand? Look at this. It's just incredible the percentage of our church that loves, loves, loves this ministry. And I thank you. I thank you so much. The walk is going to be May 9th. It's always Mother's Day weekend. I know it's a very, very busy time. It's going to be a great time. It's so much fun. Just as Cameron said, it's a lot of fun, a lot of family activities to do that day. We come together, and when you see all of your church family participating, we enjoy each other's company as we take a two-mile walk. It's just $25 to register to be a walker, but if you can't walk, you know, just give us a sponsorship. Help someone else to be able to participate. And, you know, if there's something else you think you might like to get involved in this Pregnancy Help Center ministry, we have all kinds of needs for volunteers. And you may think you don't have a thing you could give, but we will match you up. Whatever you're good at doing, if you like to answer the phone, if you like to if you like to do data entry, there's 8 acres of property. You know there are always projects to be done there. We would love to have you. And if you would come alongside us to be a prayer warrior, we often get urgent prayer requests by email of something that's going on that very moment, of some spiritual battle that needs to be done on behalf of an abortion-minded family, and you want to be a part of that, just stop by the table and give me your email address, and we'll put you on that list. Guys, this is a great ministry. I'm passionate about it. I know that you are passionate about it. We are making a difference. You are making a difference. Our theme this year is Hold On to Hope. That's what we want to give these families, is hope in the midst of their crisis. Walk alongside them for these 9 months. Help them get to that point where they could see that with the gospel of Jesus Christ in their lives, things can be different. There is hope for a future. Thank you, guys. You are making a difference.
Let me just, the topic for the sermon today and over the next several weeks, I'm not going to say it's a difficult topic, but I approach it with caution because I know that when you're sitting there, people are at all different places in their lives. So I need you to hear, I'm not picking on you, okay? The topic is households, our homes, and I know we've had people go through struggles in their homes. I know we have people going through struggles in their homes. There are folks that have just, you'd say, boy, my home life, my marriage is just perfect. Well, they're liars here too. They're good, but there's nothing perfect this side of Jesus Christ. I just need you to hear me. What we're talking about is what God says, and anybody that has gone through struggles in their marriage, whether it be your marriage or a loved one's marriage, you know the hurt and the issues there. So we are compelled by God to speak to these issues. If in the process I say something, you go, I'm not real sure about that, I want you to know that my door is always open. And I'm available to deal with you and talk to you. And if I misspeak, if you bring it to my attention and I was wrong in something according to Scripture, I'll come back and admit it, and we'll deal with it right here. But I think this is a very important topic as we begin the series entitled Desperate Households. Today we're looking at the sermon that I've entitled Homes by Design. We're going to be in Genesis, and then we're going to be in Matthew. So if you want to go ahead and flip over to Genesis, it's an easy one to find. You can actually just, it's the first book, the first chapter, and we'll be there in just a few moments. You know, recently I had one of those Saturday afternoon type rainy days. I know there's not many of those, but it was one of those days, and I was sitting in my recliner and I was relaxing my eyes, which means I was taking a nap. And the television was on, and when I woke up, my eyes said, it's time to quit relaxing, and the television was on, and so I just kind of started scanning, and I ran across a 30-minute program that, as I stopped on it, I realized, according to the guide, that it was like a marathon, all these back-to-back, same program, different episodes. It was about, I'm trying to remember, I think it was Veronica Mars. It was about a girl who was in high school. She was the main character. She had apparently had aspirations of being a private detective. So she was practicing that trade in the high school. There might be a need for that, but interesting storyline anyway. What really caught my attention, though, was not the show itself. It was in between two of the episodes. They had a young man on there, a boy, who was talking about the show. And he made the comment, I like the show because Veronica's situation is much like mine. And it seems that on the show, the best I could figure out, her father, she lived with her father. He had been a police officer or police chief or something in a small town, had gotten fired, probably wrongly, turned into a private detective. Her mother apparently had left the home, probably had an affair, what I could gather. And the boy said something to this effect. He said, I realized that she had a family like mine. And it helped me see that my family was normal. And I guess what struck me was that word normal. And I thought, what's normal? What's a normal family? What's a typical family today? Well, we know it's changed over the years. I mean, I grew up, and I'm going to date myself real quickly here. I grew up watching Ozzie and Harriet and Leave It to Beaver. You know, mom, dad, and two or three kids. Those were the normal families. There were some shows that depicted single parenting, and that was my three sons and a family affair, and in both of those cases, there had been death of one of the spouses. And then, of course, coming along behind that was the Brady Bunch and a blended family, and it has gone from there to we're not even going to talk about what it shows on television today. And so you get the idea. The fact may well be that today there are no standards, there is no norm, so everything's normal. At least that's what the world wants us to think. Normal is what's right for you. Typical is what's right for you, and there's no right or wrong. But I think that's where we get into some huge problems. As a matter of fact, I think that's especially what's going on with the situation that we've just prayed about this morning in the Supreme Court. What is family? How do you define marriage? Now, I think we would quickly agree that we're living in a time that marriages, households, are in desperate situation. Families are in trouble. Now, before I read the text, I want to take some time to talk about what's happening in our families. According to a 2011 Pew Research poll, in 1960, 72% of adults, all adults between 18 and older, were married. 72%. 1960, 50 years later, in 2010, 51% of all adults 18 and up were married. That's a drop of, 21%. The report also noted that other adult living arrangements, including cohabitation, single-person households, and single parenthood, have all grown to be prevalent in recent decades. Now, I tried to get a grasp on the divorce rate, and it's hard to grab hold of. It depends on who you're reading and how they're counting, and it's some interesting things you find there. But let's just say that nearly somewhere around 50% of all marriages end in divorce today. Now, it's an easier statistic to find is what happens to second and third marriages. Now, if you're in your second or third, take this to be something that you need to work on, okay? It's not going to be all roses. Statistics tell us that 60 to 67% of second marriages fail. Isn't that interesting? Because most people are going into a second marriage, they're going to say it's not going to be like it was before. And when you get to third marriages, 70 to 73% of third marriages fail. Now, some will look at these statistics and go, okay, marriage isn't working. First marriage isn't working. Second marriages, third marriages, they're not working. So we're just going to cohabitate. We're going to live together so that way we can make sure this is going to work before we get married. Well, let me give you another statistic. Several. Cohabitation has increased sevenfold from 1970 to 1993. You say, well, maybe that's a good thing. Well, listen to the statistic here. There's many reasons why it's not a good thing, other than the fact that God says it's not a good thing. But we're going to talk about that in a second. Of those people that cohabitate, nearly half of those couples will break up before marriage ever takes place. Of those that do get married, two-thirds will divorce. So the statistics say that 4 out of 5 cohabitating couples will not have a lasting marriage. But they thought if we try it, then it'll ensure that it works. I love what Dr. Barbara Markey says. She says, you cannot practice permanence. The more I read that, the more I like that statement. You can't practice permanence. Now, we can spend the entire morning dealing with the issues and facts and figures, real-life examples that would bring us all to tears, and then we can have some clever statements, we can have some little slogans we can throw on top of them, but I don't think that's going to help. I think we need to look at what's going on and figure out how we've got here and what we've got to do. How do we look at it in such a way that we can get to where it should be? Now, there'll be some, just to kind of wrap up some statistical thought, there'll be some that will say the divorce stats of the church are basically the same as the world. And you've read those statistics, about 50%. The problem with that is that depends on how you ask the question. What they're doing in most of those where they use that 50% number, they're saying, are you a Christian? And you say, yes. And then they say, well, how many divorces happened in those people that say they are Christians or they are connected to a church? Well, look around. Being connected to church doesn't mean you're actively involved. when you get to the point that you start looking and say, are you committed to your faith? Are you committed to the church? Are you active in regular attendance to church? Are you active in the involvement of the church? The divorce rate drops drastically. Now, it's not a guarantee, but there's a huge drop. So what do we do to help marriages? What do we do to help those who are looking to marriage in the future? Well, here's what I thought about. If you have purchased a product, and you want to know how best to utilize that product, how to get the most out of it, how to make it most effective, what do you do? Now, I'm not talking about you type A people like me that figure we can fix it without reading the instructions, but don't you go to the manufacturer? Don't you look at the manual? Yeah, you look and you say, how have they designed this product to work? You know, as a matter of fact, I can have a pocket knife, and it can be a warranted pocket knife, and it can be a good pocket knife, but if I use this as a screwdriver and I break the tip, guess what they're not going to do? I can take it to Ken all day long. Say, Ken, I bought this from you. And you said you'd stand behind it. And he'd say, yeah, and I sell screwdrivers over here. If you'd have used a screwdriver as a screwdriver and the knife as a knife, we'd warrant it. Well, sometimes I get the idea that we do God that way. God, we did it our way. What happened? And God really kind of wants to say, yeah, you did it your way, and you see what happened. So the best place we can go to find out what marriage is supposed to be is to God's Word. Let God tell us. He's the Creator. He's the one that instituted marriage. What does He say? Let's go to the owner's manual. And we find that in Genesis chapter 1. Let's read verses 26 and 27. Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. They will rule the fish of the sea and the birds of the sky and the animals and all the earth and all and the creatures that crawl on the earth. So God created man in his own image. He created him in the image of God. He created them male and female. God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, and subdue it. Rule the fish of the sea and the birds of the sky and every creature that crawls on the earth. Now turn over one page to Genesis chapter 2. Look at verses 20 through 24. Genesis 2, 20 through 24. The man gave names to all the livestock, to the birds and the sky, and to every wild animal, but for man no helper was found who was like him. So the Lord God caused deep sleep to come over the man, and he slept. God took one of his ribs and closed the flesh at that place. Then the Lord made the rib he had taken from the man into a woman and brought her to man. And man said, whoa, this one at last is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. This one will be called woman, for she is taken from man. This is why a man leaves his father and mother and bonds to his wife, and they become one flesh. Now I'm going to go ahead and read the next one, although it's not on the slide, I don't think. Both the man and his wife were naked, yet felt no shame. Now let's jump over to the New Testament. Matthew chapter 19. Matthew 19. Verses 4 through 6. Haven't you read, he replied, Jesus speaking, that he who created them in the beginning, so he's talking about himself, made them male and female, and he also said, for this reason a man will leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they will no longer be two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, man must not separate. Often today we point to the scripture, and when we start saying this is what God's word says, people say, well, that's old, that's antiquated, that was back then, but we have evolved, we have come to a place of better enlightenment. And we shouldn't go so far back to grab information and try to apply it to today. Well, think about what Jesus did when he spoke in Matthew. Jesus is a perfect example, right? When Jesus spoke in Matthew, he referred back to Genesis. Genesis was written somewhere between 1445 B.C. and 1405 B.C. And the events that took place in Genesis chapter 1 to chapter 11 was somewhere around 2090 B.C. That means that Jesus made his statement recorded in Matthew, reaching back some 1400 years and pointing to an event that took place 2,000 years before. Now, I don't know about you, but if Jesus can reach back into time like that to use as his statement, then we can too. If it was applicable for him to reach that far back, then it's applicable for us to reach that far back. It's okay. And we should never back down from the Word of God. We don't have to be ashamed of it. We don't have to apologize for it. We ought to stand on it. In his commentary, Kenneth Matthews writes, Genesis stands second to none in the importance of proclaiming the whole will of God. It presents the literary and theological underpinning of the whole canonical scriptures. If we possessed a Bible without Genesis, we would have a house of cards without foundation and without mortar. Our homes are designed and to be designed by the Creator God. One man, one woman for life. He creates us to complement each other and to enjoy each other, to procreate and to subdue the earth. The first sentence of Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 is loaded. Jesus said, let us, the plural form, God, the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, all involved in the creation process, let us make. That word make, meaning to complete with a distinct purpose or goal in view. So when God made us, he had a goal in view. He had purpose for us. Let us make man, male, female, in our image, according to our likeness. That word likeness is often used to create a simile comparing unlike things that are kind of alike, like wicked people and venomous snakes. You know, you're not saying it's the same, but sometimes they act that way. He's comparing us to himself. He said, you're like me, but you're not exactly like me. You're different. When we take a close look at the way God created, and the fact that he had every one of us with a goal in view. He created us in his Trinitarian image. We are body, mind, and soul. Use that word image and likeness. Although created in the model of God, we are different from God. He is higher than we are. We can never be God. We will never be equal to God. Therefore, we have no right, listen to this, we have no right to redefine and repurpose God's creation. We don't get that opportunity. I saw an interview on Facebook that somebody had posted of a guy who was speaking, and he was speaking for biblical marriage, and somebody confronted him and they said, but if I'm in a gay relationship and I want to have a gay marriage, and he said, you can't do that. And he said, what? And he said, you can do the gay relationship, but you can't do gay marriage, because by definition of God, marriage is between a man and a woman. And he just kept taking that guy right back to Genesis, because God defined it, God established it, you don't get to change it. When we look closely at Genesis 2, we see that God had a task for Adam in naming all the animals. Adam noticed among all the animals there was not even one like him. So God created Eve. But isn't it interesting, in chapter 1, God says, let us make them male and female. Before, in chapter 2, he created the female. It was already in his heart. It was already in his mind. He was just helping Adam see that he needed her. As he was looking at all the others, and then there was God creating Eve, the woman, to be a helpmate for Adam. Verse 22 is interesting to me, to be in Genesis, and especially with the situation that we have right there, because it says, this is why a man leaves his father and mother and bonds to his wife, and they become one flesh. Wait a minute. Adam and Eve didn't have mom and dad. So when God made that statement, he wasn't talking about Adam and Eve. He was looking to the relationships that would be coming following that. He was saying, I've created two to start the whole thing, but then as it goes forward, the man will leave his mother and father and cleave to his own wife, and they shall become one flesh. The King James, and you can tell what I grew up memorizing, the King James uses the word cleave. We used in Holman Christian bonds. It means to stick to join together, to stay with. There's a sense of permanence there. And he kind of tops it off, demonstrating the permanence, when he said, "And the two shall become one flesh." First, this is physical. One flesh expresses both our individuality in gender and our oneness with our mate through physical union. But think about what he said. See, in our sex-crazed society, it's all about our needs and our desires and our wants and our happiness. But we see something much deeper here. But I don't want to come across as sometimes the church has in times past making it sound like sex is a bad thing. It's not. It's a good thing. It's a pleasurable thing. But it to be what God has intended it to be, it has to be within the bounds that He set up, and that is the bounds of marriage. Now, the word that God uses here, where we translate it that flesh, one flesh, it denotes blood relationships. And I got to thinking about that. How can a husband and wife be blood related? That's not legal, number one, guys. You don't marry your sister or your cousin. Jerry is my wife, not my sister, not my cousin. Okay? That's wrong. Gross. Unhealthy. But a husband and wife can only meet this one flesh, this blood relation, through procreation. Think about it. When a baby is formed, then you've got that blood where the two coming together, now there's that combination, that oneness. So that's part of the purpose of marriage. Not the only purpose, but part of one of the primary purposes of marriage is that of procreation, and the Creator Himself designed it that way. I believe we can also legitimately extend this one flesh to be emotional and spiritual in realm, because we're created Trinitary, body, mind, and emotion, and soul. The union between a husband and wife, the union between a man and a woman, involves all three aspects of who we are by God's creative design. That's why when I hear someone say, "Oh, it's just sex," I'm going, "You don't have a clue. You don't have a clue," because it's not just physical, it's emotional. I've seen people that would have never, ever had said we belong together, but at a time in when they one or both were weak and they went into that bond, sexual bond, let me tell you, something happens to their emotions, something happens to us that ties us together. And it's not just physical, because God designed people that way. And if you have gotten, or anybody, I won't say you, if someone gets to that place where they say, "For me, it is just physical," you're telling me you're so deep in sin that you have so seared your emotions that nothing can get through. Because God didn't design you for it not to affect all parts, your entire being. And then God says there needs to be this permanence. He says what God has joined together, man must not separate. Now, we're just about out of time. But let me real quickly hit this last section. When we go back to see where God designed marriage and the purpose God designed it for, it answers two huge questions of debate in our day. Number one, Kim's already talked about, and that is abortion. I've had people say, oh, we don't want to hear about that because that's political. Folks, it is biblical that has been tried to be played out in the political realm. Life is from God. God created everyone in His image. Humans are the crown of His creation. It is only after the creation of man. Every time God created, each day He looked at what He had done and He said, man, that's good. But after He created man, He looked and He said, that's very good. The crown of His creation. So if procreation is a major role for husbands and wives, then ending a life of a baby is sinful. Because it's taking a life of one that has been created in the image of God. And you say, but what about? Quit giving me those what abouts. Because God can take what was meant for evil and make it good. Are there some terrible things? Yes. Are there avenues to help with those things? That's why we have the Pregnancy Help Center. We shouldn't be beating people down. We ought to be helping them out. To see that this is a beautiful life. This is a special life. Folks, I can't give the answer to so many questions other than the fact we live in a fallen world. But wasn't it just this weekend down at the high school they were having the Special Olympics? And you say, well, but those people, wouldn't it have been better if they had not been born? Absolutely not. They're a creation of God. They are having some struggles there. But don't we? I'm sometimes wondering who's normal. We're all created by God, and we all live in a fallen world, and we all have to deal with the struggles of a fallen world. But that doesn't lessen the value of human life. We ought to be standing for life. Number two, the issue, same-sex marriage. Listen, ultimate oneness and union found in marriage can only be possible through heterosexual marriage. If nothing else, it's a scientific thing. It's biology. Man created us, God created us, man and woman. Now, I don't think we need to be out here making jokes about it. I don't think we need to be calling names. I think we need to glorify God in the way we deal with these issues. And we don't do that by being dirty and nasty with the way we handle it. We ought to be demonstrating God's love. Last Wednesday night, we looked at the fact that before God was creator, He was love. Because He was before creation. And so we take the love of God and we give the truth of God, and then it becomes the work of the Holy Spirit. Homosexual relationships physically cannot achieve the union that God has designed for those that are heterosexual. Marriage cannot procreate because God made it that way. And here's the deal. If you purchase a product and then you file a claim, just like we said a while ago, the first thing they're going to say is, how'd you use it? And we have all these things going on in our world today, and people are saying, but this isn't working and that didn't work, because we have gotten away from the manual that God gave us. We have problems with heterosexual marriage because we're trying to do it our way. Most of us are, that's why I like this series, the marriage videos, The Art of Marriage, because one of the first things that's said on there is that you're selfish. And that's true. Every one of us wants what's best for us. And God has said, and we're going to talk more about that in the weeks ahead, that my goal ought to be what's best for that lady right there. And what will honor God. But you know what? Her, and I'm pointing to my wife, by the way. but her goal ought to be what's best for me and what honors God. And quit worrying about ourselves. But we've made such a terrible stand. And sometimes as Christians, we talk about so many things that marriage is supposed to be. Even in the church, marriage is supposed to be all about love. And they're taking that, and they're running over here and saying, well, I'm a he, and I love a he. And so it ought to be marriage. Well, Josh and I went to the associational office this week, and we walked in there, and he loved that goldfish. That's what he said. Does that mean he can marry that goldfish? Katie says no. Folks, it's not about that. Most of what we talk about love is emotion. And we have so defined ourselves sexually that's where we get our identity. Let me tell you where we get our identity. The image of God. It's not in the sex, it's in the image of God. And so he says, I created you in my image, so I have every right to say what marriage will look like, and here's how I've designed it. And we need to stand for it. Marriage, especially marriage between Christians, ought to be a beautiful picture of the relationship between Christ and the church. And for most of us, we'd have to hang our heads and say it's not. I got a great marriage. I love my wife. She loves me. But there are times that our relationship doesn't give a very beautiful picture of the relationship between Christ and the church. So we need to start by asking God to forgive us where we failed. Asking God to strengthen our marriages. And then ask God to give us the strength to stand for what His Word says. To pray that His will be done and He will be victorious in this. And you say, well, what if He's not? Then we still stand for marriage. Biblical marriage. Folks, the other side is not concerned about anything other than pressing an agenda. You say, how do you know that? And I'll close with this. A judge just awarded $135,000 in damages to a same-sex couple that asked a baker to make a cake, and they said no. Now, I don't know how many bakers there are in this world. I think that was in Oregon, but my guess is bakers are a dime a dozen. They're all over the place. So no one was saying, this Christian was not saying, you can't get married. They just said, we disagree with it. We're not going to be a part of it. But the agenda is that we will buy into whatever kind of sin the world wants to throw out there. We've got to take a stand. I've talked to students about it, and let me tell you, they have a more difficult time than we did when I was growing up. Because I didn't know many of those folks. I knew them, I just didn't know they were what they were, probably. But here's what I hear from students sometimes. Well, they're wonderful people. They are. They're nice people. Yeah. They're our friends. I understand. But God says this is right and this is wrong. You say, are you picking on the homosexuals? Absolutely not. I'll say the same thing about any kind of sex outside of marriage. Okay? There are heterosexual people that I won't do the wedding for. We've got to go back to God's standards. Is everybody going to love us? Absolutely not. But we're on the right side. But we need to do it saying, we're here for you. We're here for you to help you in living the way God wants you to live. It's time that we become the people of God that He calls us to be. We've sat on the sidelines way too long. So in the weeks ahead, we're going to talk about the roles of husbands and the roles of wives and then parenting. And then we're going to come back and deal with a passage that deals with the oneness. You say, well, what if I'm not married? That's okay. Nothing in the Bible says you have to be. But it has some parameters for the single life. Let's do it God's way. I just believe if we do it that way, He will bless. I just believe if we do it that way, we'll see it work. What do we need to do? What do you need to do? There might be some here today that you need to just come and pray, maybe for your marriage, maybe for a marriage of a loved one. We've already had an opportunity to pray, but it's still time to pray for the Supreme Court decision. You know, to get people on God's word and on God's page, it will normally start with a relationship with Jesus Christ. See, the world doesn't have the standard before them that we do. But once we present the word to them and we say, here's God, and you can have a personal relationship with Him, then they say, oh, well, God makes a difference. So we need to always be sharing the gospel. There might be somebody you need to share the gospel with that's going to be a difficult situation. You don't share the gospel because they're homosexual. You share the gospel because they're lost.